victims of sexual assault and their supporters have long said the court process is daunting, with many victims stating that they feel re-traumatised by it. Well, that may be a thing of the past. The first reading of the sexual violence legislation bill happens this afternoon, and the bill will tighten the rules around evidence about a complainant's sexual history, as well as allowing them the right to choose how they want to give evidence. For more on this, we're joined by victims advocate Ruth Money. Good morning, Ruth.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for being with us this morning. It's such an important issue.
It really is. Yeah, and long overdue.
Long overdue. Can you just sort of give us an idea of the current court environment and how that may put people off from actually reporting sexual violence?
Well, you know, you don't know what you don't know, so a court is really terrifying for everyone. And you have, you know, you're sitting in a little box and you have someone literally leaning over you, raising their voice, saying, you know, well, you didn't stop it, you didn't, you know, well, how did you feel? Even back in the 1980s, what did you wear? And we're still getting that now. So it's a very traumatic event and it's embarrassing. You don't want to talk about this stuff and you certainly don't want to talk about it in front of a panel of jury, strangers. It's horrific.
One of the changes is they're going to restrict how much they can dig into someone's sexual history.
Good.
Which is amazing. I mean, but what could they do in the past? Why would they bring up someone's sexual history?
Yeah, it's so archaic and it really does need to change. So we're glad that this bill is being, starting to be read. Why, I guess the argument was, which I never understood, but the legal argument is it's propensity. It shows a behaviour.
Right.
Very archaic.
So if you're sexually active, then you kind of inviting it?
You is might have the invited the sexual assault.
Right.
Yeah, it's completely inappropriate and it's got to go.
What does that make a person feel like? How does it
This is why people don't come forward. And I have so many of my survivors who say the courtroom was worse than the rape or the sexual assault itself. And if that happens in New Zealand, then we need to hurry up and pass this bill so that more people come forward, because that doesn't help. You know, if you don't come forward, it doesn't necessarily help you with your healing and your journey, but it also doesn't help the person who offended, because they don't get held accountable and they don't get the help that they need.
Mm.
So then we're just in this bubble or this vortex really that sees more harm being perpetuated throughout the community, and it's devastating.
Do you think that the bill goes far enough in protecting victims?
No, I never do, Ruth, the victim advocate. Most of these suggestions were, in fact, all of these suggestions came in a 2015 Law Commission report, and we're now in 2019 for the first reading. It does look at sexual assault in a civil manner as well, which is good. But I think, you know, if you look at some of the cases that happen every day in these courtrooms, there needs to be more humanity, full stop, for all victims. But certainly, let's start with the sexual complainants and get a model to go from there.
As well as looking into their sexual history, it's going to change how a victim can choose. They can choose how they're going to give evidence.
Yes.
Can you explain what's going
on? So important. So at the moment, you have to be in court and you're cross-examined in front of the accused, in front of the jury of strangers, and whoever else happens to be in the public gallery, unless the judge has closed the court. So this now will look at procedures for you being able to be cross-examined, pre-recorded. So, and that is so important from a quality of evidence perspective, mm-hmm. but from my perspective, actually, more important for the health of my survivor. So mentally and physically, giving evidence in person and being cross-examined by really officious and mean and degrading. Here's a picture of the bra you wore, defence lawyers, it's so archaic, it's got to stop, and this will allow that to change.
That example of the bra has been brought up before, and you said you were in the court when this actually happened. Was it a normal looking bra?
It's just a florally bra. You know, you would see it on the beach. It's a bikini top, right? Mm. And actually, what if she didn't wear one? Does that still mean that she deserved what she got? How that person treated her? Absolutely not. And that's why these laws have to change, and they have to change quickly.
And this is almost blaming the victim for what someone's done to them.
Another good thing about the bill is that it actually now requires judges to talk to jury and around rape myths and consent type myths. So there'll be some education that happens and some direction in the court, whereas that doesn't happen at the moment.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're on the right path.
We're getting there.
Yeah, getting there. Thank you so much for your time this morning, Ruth Money.
A shout out to you, Ruth, for the work you've done. And also, we did a series of interviews in May on this. Mm-hmm. People were getting really angry about it. The bra example, I was staggered that the defence lawyer introduced the bra as if that, you know, suggested that the woman was. Anyway, I just want to do a shout out to Elizabeth McDonald, researcher. Yes. Tracy Topp, who told the story of what happened to her. Kirsten Lummis, Crown Prosecutor, some of the women who spoke up at that time. It made a difference. You've all made a difference. This stuff matters.
We'll get there slowly.
Speaking up matters.